Thank you so much for inviting me to give a keynote here at this wonderful and important conference and in this beautiful building. I'm usually here in the winter time, in the ball season. This is another opportunity to go to this wonderful palace. But now we have to work hard because we have many, many challenges to cope with in the next future. And this is the topic of my presentation, how education can promote social progress. My presentation has two parts. In the first part, I will give you insight in a, I think, very important and really challenging endeavor, the so-called International Panel on Social Progress. And in particular, I will focus on the chapter 19 of this panel, the contribution of education to social progress, because I'm involved, very intensively involved, in this chapter. I have not enough time to go in detail, but I will give you a very few insights in the purpose of access to and quality of education and the policy recommendation we provided in this chapter. And then I will focus, because this conference is on higher education, on universities, on the contribution of higher education to promote social progress. And particularly, and this is the second part of my presentation, I will focus on the third mission of universities. And as an example, I will present you the third mission at the University of Vienna. Let's start with the International Panel on Social Progress. Rethinking society for the 21st century. When you go to the website of this panel, then you will find the sentence. The International Panel on Social Progress is uniting the world's leading researchers, sociologists, and economists in a single effort, developing research-based, multidisciplinary, non-partisan, action-driven solutions to the most pressing challenges of our time. Or to make it simple, it's a bottom-up initiative from many, many researchers with the idea we have to cope with so many challenges, populism, war, refugees, climate change, demography, and so on. And the social sciences have so much knowledge about to cope with this, but there's a need to bring this knowledge together. And this is the intention of this panel. The issues addressed in the IPSB are democracy and citizenship, poverty, inequality, well-being, global risks, resources, markets, finance and corporations, private and public governance, the future of work, violence, peace and security, global health, religions and secularism, gender, family production, sexuality, urban issues, urban cultural relations, education, communication, and media. You can see these are the most challenging topics we have to cope with in the next future. But we have also four cross-cutting themes that are weaved through the report. These are technology and innovation, globalization, social movements, and identity and community. And we got the tasks for each of the chapters, for each of the topics, to examine within the report, within the chapters, the following questions. What is the current situation? And what are the historical and prospective trends? What direction of change can be inspired by the search for social justice? And what are the drivers and barriers for such a change? You can expect that such an endeavor needs a clear organization. And I will only give you a very few insights on that. We have an honorary advisory committee. This is composed of real, distinguished moral and intellectual leaders. And among them are several Nobel Prize winners, as for example, Amartya Sen or Kenneth Arrow. Then there is a steering committee in the Scientific Council. But the heart of the IPSB are the authors. There are between 250 and 300 leading academics and researchers from all around the world, from different disciplines, but we also need financial support and resources, and therefore we have scientific and institutional partners. This process started in 2014. We have now, I think 1 week ago, we finished our chapter after several revisions and a lot of work on that, and all the whole volume will be published in 2018 by Cambridge University Press. This work will have 22 chapters and around 1,000 pages. But you can see we need to work with the politicians because no policymaker, no politicians will read 1,000 pages. That means we worked along the process with policymakers, with people from economy, but we have to continue to do so. Here, I really recommend to go to the website of the IPSB, and there you can also find a small booklet which gives you an overview about the work, but also here you can see a few of the people and organizations who supported the IPSB. I will now move to the chapter I'm intensely involved in. This is the chapter 19, the contribution of education to social progress. I'm the coordinating lead also of this chapter together with Simon Schwarzmann. He's from Brazil, from the Institute for Studies and Labor and Society. And we have, as you can see, a lot of leading authors coming from different disciplines, but also from different regions. Because the idea is not only to focus on the OECD countries, but to have a global perspective in this panel. A global perspective, that means we have also people from Brazil, from India, from Israel, and so on, also in our chapter, and this is the case also in other, and beyond these leading authors, we have also a big number of contributing authors for our chapter, but also for the other ones. Here you have a picture when we have a meeting in Vienna to work on the chapter. And I, as I mentioned before, for time reasons, I cannot go very much in detail, but I would like to give you some insight. Starting with why education is a central tool for social progress. Because from our perspective, education is the process of learning and expanding culture, and as it contributes to the improvement of the human condition through better knowledge, health, living conditions, social equity and productivity, it is a central tool for social progress. In our chapter, we defined four purposes of education which are related and which contribute to social progress. The first one is the humanistic, through the development of the individual and collective human virtus to the full extent. Second, the civic, by the enhancement of public life and active participation in a democratic society, economic, providing the individuals with intellectual and practical skills that make them productive and enhance theirs and society's living conditions, and, very important, through social equity and justice. I think in the first step, and this is what we did in this chapter, you had to look at the current situation. And here I will focus on two, I think, the most important issues. The first one is the access to education, but the second one, and very maybe also important, is the quality of education. Here on this figure, you can see access to education across different regions, but also across different educational levels. And I will focus with you first on the primary education. And here you can see primary education, we are in a relative good situation because we have really high involvement rates across all regions. But if you look at all educational levels, then you can see we have best situation in Europe, followed by Oceania, which means we have good enrollment rates in pre-primary education and secondary education, but not as high in tertiary education. And the poorest regions are Africa, followed by the Arab states. And if you look at Africa, then you can see very low rates in pre-primary education and tertiary education, but also not very high in secondary education. But nevertheless, we're looking back, we have really did a great step forward, because between 1999 and 2012, The number of out-of-school children dropped from approximately 115 to 57 million. But this is the problem. This rate of progress has significantly stagnated since 2007. And the problem is also that those remaining out of school are among the most disadvantaged. That means in these countries I mentioned before, in Africa and Arab states. That means children in conflict-affected countries, children with disabilities, and children really from the poorest families. But not access matters, but also the quality of education matters. And when we are looking at the data, we could see that millions of students in rich but mostly in low-income countries go through school without learning to read and understand a simple text, without becoming able to solve a simple arithmetic problem or to have a grasp of very simple scientific facts. And again, the poorest, that means coming from Africa and Arab state, coming from disadvantaged families, those are very much targeted of these problems. That means we have a confrontation here, and this is really a very poor situation. And I think this is a very interesting figure. What shows us this figure? This figure shows us the proportion of people from different countries who are worried about not being able to give children good education. And this means that people are really aware of this situation. And on the top, you have countries like the Netherlands, Sweden, Australia. And here you can also see, because these are rich countries and successful countries, but nevertheless, more than 20% of the people are worried about not being able to give children good education. And if you go down, here you can see, it's very difficult to read. Malaysia is the poorest one. And here you can see more than 90% worried about it. More than 90%. That means education matters, and education is really also a very important topic in the mind of the people. Okay, because of time reason, I will now go to the policy recommendations we did in our chapter, and we start on the global level. On a global level, we think that more research-informed policy is required, which you know is a big debate now. We need evidence-based policy making and also a balanced approach to education reform, including teacher education, by putting more emphasis on the civic and on the humanistic purpose, and not so much and on the economic purpose, having in mind all the problems we have to cope with, industry, the digitalization, and so on. And furthermore, we recommend, because we have also several chapters on governance structures, that these should be flexible, participatory, and accountable, considering the political and social context. We think that this new agenda of sustainable developmental goals for 2030, which have been established in 2015, which calls for a new cooperative paradigm based on the concept of full global partnership and the principle of no one will be left behind, give a good framework. In particular, the Sustainable Developmental Goal for Education, which aims to ensure inclusive and quality education for all and promote lifelong learning. And this provides a framework for the educational's contribution to social progress. And to achieve this, we in particular recommend to expand access and improve the quality of early education. Early childhood education is a precondition for lifelong education success in all its goals, to improve the quality of schools, that means making education institutions to perform well, to enhance the role of educators, considering that teachers are not just carriers of knowledge and information, but also role models that have a significant impact on children's dispositions towards learning and life more generally, and to making higher and vocational education more inclusive and socially relevant, That means enhancing the opportunities for students of all sectors of society to further their education in a meaningful and practical way, eliminating social and cultural restrictions to access and reducing the dividing lines between high and low prestige, between institutions and carriers. And finally, we also recommend a proper use of the opportunities created by the new digital technologies. From our perspective, they are not a magic bullet that will replace the existing educational institutions and create a new learning world, but we think they can be powerful instruments to improve the quality and relevance of education and its contribution to social progress. This is a very brief overview, very shortened one, about this chapter on education, but I will now more focus on higher education and the contribution higher education can make to social progress. We think that there are three qualities areas for all educational institutions, from kindergarten up to universities, and these are the quality of processes, the quality of structures, and the quality of orientation. What does it mean? Quality of processes means the learner's direct interactions in the group setting with the educator and with the physical environment. Structures, quality of structures means the framework surrounding interactions, including characteristics such as group size, student-teacher ratio, teacher qualifications, and spatial and material conditions. In Austria, for example, we have now a big debate at the universities whether we will get a new kind of university funding taking into account the number of students. And this is currently not the situation. The third quality area is the quality of orientation. This includes the curriculum, the concrete curriculum, the educational approach, but also the goals and values of the staff members. And how can the higher education institutions contribute to social progress? We think in the following, they can do it in the following perspectives. The first, the continuous relevance of the Enlightenment values for higher education, which is really the case if you are going to an university. The role of higher education in the creation of economic growth and wealth, both by teaching and by research, but also the higher education's importance in strengthening social inclusion and equity and equality. But we have to take into account, as you could see from the numbers of students enrolled in the different levels of education, that especially the access to higher education is a privilege of middle and upper class, also sometimes in the richer countries, not only in the poor countries. But we think, and this is the topic I will now focus in the final part of my presentation, that the so-called third mission could be a prominent agenda for the civic goal of education. And with this goal and with the third mission, universities can contribute to social progress. Third mission. I think if you go back in the history, everybody would, I think, would agree that there is a kind of implicit social contract between science and society. That means universities provide research and teaching in return for public funding, but they have a really high degree of institutional autonomy. This varies between countries, but the autonomy is, I think, really high. But in the last years, there's a kind of renegotiation of the social contract in such a way that, for example, it was formulated by Gaston and Keniston, that the scientific community needs to reach out to justify its claim on public resources by demonstrating where and how it is relevant in solving public problems. And that means there's a really emerging expectation that universities not only produce new knowledge, but do so with social and economic perspectives in mind. That means universities are requested to use the results produced by the first and second missions, first mission teaching, second mission research, to address the growing social, economic, and societal challenges. And also, and I think this is very important, also for you, including third mission as mindset in teaching, having in mind also the alumni. And this implies that universities and also the single members are forced to taking responsibility actively and consciously for the society on whose behalf they are working. The term third mission, the term that means transfer, is but a collective term for different activities which use scientific knowledge to help shape societal development. And there is really a rich variety of third mission activities that already been carried out in research or in teaching at different universities worldwide. For example, social engagement, service learning, knowledge transfer, children's university. The Vienna Children's University starts on Monday and they celebrate its 20th anniversary, yes? Because we started very early and we have, I think, 4,000 or 5,000 children coming to this university for not only the Vienna University, several universities work together here to prepare the Children's University. And this is, I think, a really very successful way to transfer the knowledge we have and to make universities attractive for young people. But the problem is we have many activities, different activities at many universities, but most of them have not been formally identified. Formally identified, that means that they are visible, that the rector knows what is going on, visible on websites and so on, and are not really interconnected. And I think this is one of the big problems, and to cope with this situation, we need strategies at the universities to develop the universities in such a way that the universities as an institution take over this responsibility of a third mission, the transfer. And I will show you the third mission at the university, in particular the strategy project we conducted at the University of Vienna as an example. This project, third mission of the University of Vienna, was commissioned by the rector. That means it's very important that the rector stand behind such an important project. And I'm, together with my colleagues Barbara Schober and Veronika Somoza, chairing this project. And we have also a postdoc position who supported us. We started in March 2016. And the first phase of this project will finish in February 2018. Okay, what are the aims? We have three main aims. The first one is to collectively develop a specific content-related profile for the third mission of the University of Vienna, based on the existing strengths, to develop concrete measures for implementing the third mission. For example, making activities visible and valorizing them, interconnecting activities, but also to develop quality assurance measures. And also, the third goal, to conceptualize an explicit framework for a sustainable implementation of the third mission at the University of Vienna. We defined four criteria for the third mission. The first one is the relevance for society and economy. That means the activities should expand research and teaching to society and economy in transfer. It should be based on research, but we mean based on research on the actors' own research. This is very important because third mission does not mean that the first and the second goals are less important. It means that these goals should be strengthened by adding the third mission, the transfer as goal. The third criterion is the networking with society and the economy. That means we would like to include external partners, explicitly include them. And these activities should be future-oriented and sustainable. That means they should have a longer perspective and also an impact. And we also would like to that they have implemented quality measures, if possible. Sometimes they start without quality measures, but they should have in mind to include such measures in the future. We defined three dimensions. The first dimension is social engagement or social transfer. The second, knowledge transfer. And the third, technology and innovation transfer. And we have a website, and you can go to the website and look also on the examples of these third missions activities. And now I will give you for each of the three dimensions one example by starting describing what we understand about this dimension. Social engagement refers to the targeted use of scientific knowledge for resolving manifold societal challenges. Here I would like to give you an example that comes from the Faculty of Computer Science. Responsible is Helmut Lavac, a colleague of mine for this. And it's an app that helps seriously ill children. Children with a disease of the immune system who are receiving aftercare after a hematopoietic stem cell transplantation are at significant risk for complications after hospital discharge. Therefore, a daily communication of physical parameters, that means fever, pain, fluid intake, and more, to clinicians is decisive to enable early identification of behavioral changes which precede manifest symptoms of diseases. And this project, called INTERACT, specifically focused on supporting patients' compliance by designing a child-friendly information and communication tool in the form of an app, which reminds the children to transmit their data and motivates them with entertaining video games. The second dimension is knowledge transfer. This includes the adequate preparation and sharing of scientific knowledge with target groups outside the university, that means practitioners, politicians, pupils, schools, and so on, and the systematic integration of scientific knowledge in societal discourses. Here I would like also to give you an example. This example is prepared by Oliver Radkolb. He is professor at the Faculty of Historical and Cultural Studies. It is the place of remembrance of Nazi forced labor. Due to a series of collective lawsuits regarding the reimbursement of former forced laborers and slave workers during the Nazi regime, there was massive pressure on Austrian companies, and especially on the Voestalpine as the successor of a Nazi company. And the aim of this project, Nazi forced labor in Linz, under the Reichswerke Hermann Göring AG Berlin, 1938 to 1945, was to scientifically process findings on forced labor during National Socialism with a specific focus on the company history of Voestalpine. And amongst others, the project resulted in a permanent exhibition integrated in the company. And many schools and schools classes are coming to this exhibition and to this successor of the Voestalpine to learn about history. And I think this is really very important. Maybe I should also mention that Linz is the main city, as you know, where the head office of the Applied University of Upper Austria is located. I think this is a very good example for the second third mission dimension. And I will now move to the third dimension. This is technology and innovation transfer. This involves the transfer of knowledge, know-how, ideas, technologies, innovations, and patents from the university to economic context. I would like to give you a further example. This is a project organized by Alexander Bismarck. He is professor at the Faculty of Chemistry. It is the project development of innovative polymer materials. Diminishing primary oil reserves require oil and gas production from reserves that are more difficult to access. Thus, further development of technologies and materials such as polymers, which allow to produce as much oil as possible from one well, is decisive. And the aim of the transfer activity polymer materials is to develop polymers to be applied under difficult conditions such as high temperature or pressure for optimizing of the production of oil and gas. And if you go to the website, you will find some more examples of certain missions activities in these different domains. What impact we expect of the third mission on society? And I think this is also very important. We expect an impact for university, but we also expect an impact on society. On the one hand, an extended networking between researchers and societal and economic actors, an integration of socially relevant topics in research and teaching. We also expect an increased preparation of students for taking over responsible tasks in politics, economy, and society. But also, and I think this is very important, when I have in mind the data from the Eurobarometer, and we here in Austria, we have a really poor situation in the appreciation of science and research. We expected an increase in this appreciation of science and research in the public and in the society. And finally, what contribution can come from education to social progress. In the long run, we also expect the promotion of social progress by taking over the third mission from single individuals, but also from universities as institutions. Thank you very much for your attention.